Human-wildlife conflicts continue to pose a serious threat to the survival of wildlife species in Uganda. This exhibit alone inhabits some of the wildlife that has been rescued by the Uganda Wildlife Education Center in and around communities around protected areas. The veterinary staff and animal keepers are always on standby to attend to injured, sick, or stressed animals, working closely with other stakeholders like the Uganda Wildlife Authority and communities. However, they believe that rescuing animals is just a short-term solution. Attitudes and behavioral change through creating awareness is a more sustainable approach to species survival, and that is why conservation education is valued.
We mainly rescue lots of animals from community areas. For those who are rescued from the wilderness, the national parks, sometimes they are let to go, or sometimes the vets will attend to them in the wild and let them released or let them free back home. But those that we rescue from communities end up at the zoo. This year alone, quite a number of rescues have been undertaken. This enclosure itself is an aviary for the eagles, for the vultures, and the shoebill storks. Most of the birds we have in this aviary have been rescued. The shoebill storks, these are some of the most rare birds of the world. And these are wetland dwellers, only found in wetlands. So people are encroaching rapidly on wetlands. Some people will interfere with their activities. These birds will always wander around the wetlands looking for food, and some of them breeding. Like one of them was rescued from Mabamba, just across Entebbe, after people had threatened its survival.
During the months of March and April 2016, the zoo received 36 community calls requesting them to intervene in problem animals, stray animals, or animals that are deemed dangerous to the communities.
This year alone, we've rescued some baby crocodile. One baby crocodile was rescued. We've rescued a number of rock pythons. There is one we recently rescued from Butambala. And this snake had 45 eggs. Imagine 45 eggs, and this snake was incubating her eggs. Next to the snake, 10 meters away, was a woman with her 5 children, digging not away of this animal here. Fortunately, one of them spotted the snake and called the zoo. Recently, we also received some of the kittens, Savo cat kittens from Mitiana. Communities were worried, called them leopards. They even vacated the village.
Due to distance and resource constraints, UWEC managed to respond in time to some cases, and where deemed necessary gave advice on how communities could live harmoniously with wildlife, including reducing on rates of encroachment on their habitats.
Then we have to tell people about the habitats for these animals, because people encroach without knowing what would be the repercussions.
Shake your head.
Rise up.
Captive wild animals, especially those that are not domesticated, exhibit abnormal behavior, commonly known as stereotypic behavior. Today on EcoZone, we look at enrichment, a measure that is done by the zoo to counter such abnormal behavior. Animals in zoos don't have the same opportunities for physical and mental stimulation that wild animals do. Due to this, they might develop abnormal, repetitive, and apparently purposeless behaviors, which may include pacing, self-injury, root tracing, and excessive self-grooming. These behaviors are associated with stress and lack of stimulation. Many who keep animals in captivity attempt to prevent or decrease stereotypical behavior by introducing novel stimuli known as environmental enrichment.
Right now at the lion exhibit, you can see, if you check in there, you'll find their tires. Some are lying on the ground, so you find our lions are rolling on the tires. We also present boomer balls at least once every 2 weeks. So you find the lion is playing around with a boomer ball and it feels like, hey, he's active or chasing prey. We also have some platforms for them to rest on. You can see in there, Letaba and Zara are lying on the platform, so they feel like they are advantaged If they are in the wild, you see the female is normally on top, so he can see at a big range, so he can be able to see game from a distance, and then he's able to go hunting. You can see there is another tower. We offered some feeding tower. Once in a while, we'll tie food up there. On tying food up there, so the lions will tussle it down. We'll have to jump up, pull it down, stretch it down. So by so doing, they are exercising, they are burning the fat, and they are trying to keep healthy. The rhinos, they have very wide concreted pillars within the exhibit. So they go rub the horns on the pillars and they are engaged. We give them big logs so they can roll them. We give them wallowing areas by rolling in the mud, by wallowing down there. Not only is it for keeping away the biting flies, but it's also engaging them, cooling down, and they are keeping fit.
Most enrichment materials that the zoo uses are everyday items that can be recycled or reused for their animals.
Our chimpanzees are highly, highly enriched. You see tires, you see fire horses on the island, you see logs on the island, you see termite mounds on the island. You find a chimp has picked a stick, he's scooping out honey. We could have presented in a termite mound. Maybe there are termites within the mound. So these chimpanzees will find a way of finding the termite mounds out, or I mean the termites out, and spend time on that, preying on it. So the only way you can ensure an animal is fit and healthy within your captive setting, always go for enrichment.
With 72 acres, this zoo gives an extended room to its animals, with three separate ecological systems, that is the wetland, savanna, and forest. This zoo gives room to all its animals to survive better. Today on the show, we explore the exhibits that have been designed to mimic the natural habitats of the animals.
Giving wild animals what they need in captivity can prove challenging. The best captive environment mimics elements of an animal's natural surrounding in the wild. The Entebbe Zoo, lovingly referred to as WEC, was established in 1952. This lush, sprawling zoo gives extended room to its animals, butterflies, and bird species.
The exhibit right before us is a Queen Elizabeth exhibit. This exhibit basically is a representation for Queen Elizabeth National Park in Western Uganda. This ecosystem basically has a wider savanna area and a wider forest ecosystem. All of these form the Queen Elizabeth Conservation Area. So you look at the savanna down here, where we have typical savanna animals. We have the waterbucks, we have the Uganda cob, we have the zebras. Those zebras are not found in Queen Elizabeth National Park, but the zoo, out of its own internal management, moved some of the zebras to Queen Elizabeth exhibit here at the zoo. So our Imaramagama Forest within the zoo has around four different monkey species. We have the colobus monkey, the eastern colobus monkey. We have the debraza monkeys. We have the red-tailed monkeys and the velvet monkeys.
The zoo is dedicated to quality, sustainable enclosures for its population and intimate one-on-one encounters with the animals to educate on the importance of natural preservation for optimal sporting of the inhabitants.
Yeah, like I told you, when we moved animals from cages into semi-wild enclosures, we had to devise mechanisms of safeguarding them from jumping out and visitors crossing to the animal side. The fence is low. The animals have a barrier of a dry mud. It's a depression that forms within an exhibit. So the animals will come, feed very close, but they will not go into the mud. So there is a natural barrier that is down here, so they will not easily cross this side. Why is it dry? Because these animals never swim. Should we put water and the animals accidentally fall in there, some of them would die.
Ultimately, endangered species will only be saved by preserving their habitats and combating the reasons they are killed by people.
The Uganda Wildlife Education Center is not a zoo in a conventional sense, neither is it a safari park. It's a place where wildlife education meets leisure. So next time you're looking for a place to get in touch with the wild, this might be a considerable place to be. We've come to the end of our WEC series, but we do hope you had a lot to learn from this particular segment. Do tell us what you think about the show on our Facebook page, that is Ecozone at Urban TV, and we'll be more than glad to hear from you. That is it from me and the whole team, signing out.
Wow, Charlie.